Hallelujah. Thank God for you. I'm excited, Pastor Byrne. God is doing so much stuff. He's doing so much stuff. It's incredible. Amen. And your book is also beautiful.
They wouldn't let us wear our little things yesterday when we were speaking in King of Prussia. We was trying to be obedient and compliant. Thank you for being compliant.
It's our glory today.
They had us put on our t-shirts and everybody looked amazing. Yeah. It was so such uniformity. Amen. Yeah. So I didn't want it to go to waste. So praise God.
Oh, well, it definitely wasn't. Amen. Excited about that. Excited about what God did. Why don't you share about what you had yesterday? Amen.
Oh, you know what? I'm going to ask Elder, will she come? Because I am super excited. Can you guys celebrate Elder? Yeah. I want to thank God for her. And Deacon Sharon was up there this weekend with us. We were in King of Prussia. I want to give a shout out to Pastor Tina Gladney for her hosting her vision yesterday. We were at the Desmond Hotel. And it was just a precious opportunity to be with so many powerful women of God who were leading and speaking. Pastor Melanie, who we so love and just a dear, her and her husband, Pastor in Redemptive Church, and then Pastor Dana Roof from Love of Christ Church, and Pastor Elder Sybil Bull, and Pastor Carol, so many of them. We just say thank you, and it was great. Thank you for hosting us this weekend. Amen.
Bless you, Elder.
Amen, amen. It was powerful. And you know, I'm prejudiced because, you know, Pastor Byrne just took the roof off the house. She spoke to Mary. The conference was awesome. It was just a blessed time to be there and fellowship with women. And as Pastor Byrne said, Pastor, Dr. Melody Price, she just, we'd be around her all the time and I've never heard her speak. She just loved us, loved being with us. But she was so powerful. And her title was, This Girl Is On Fire. This girl was on fire, but what she reminded us was the statistics of things that were truly happening in earth, which is still God. But we have to be mindful and stop letting it just, oh, that's something over there. Everything means something. Everything is operating in God's will, one way or the other. And she said we had to get back to getting on our post. And she said, she gave a talk where she said, they paid off their house and they got a ministry and she got a business. She said, but to have all of that and go to hell wouldn't mean nothing. So we have to realize that if our focus is just Jesus Christ and everything else to line up with, so that was powerful. Then they talked about mental health, which was just another awesome session. And then here come Pastor Byrne speaking to the married wives. I'm telling you, it's some happy husbands. No, I'm telling you, it's some happy husbands this morning. If they could even wait to get back today, because it's the end of today. But she came and she just reminded her title. She played Michael Jackson, I'm bad, I'm bad. And her title was, I'm a bad, B-A-A-D wife.
Amen.
Bold, anointed, armed and dangerous. Bold, anointed, armed and dangerous. Those ladies left out there with some ammunition yesterday. She talked about the history of, she gave her Dr. Day's history and the process and when things went left and how they brought them back under the will of God. And she reminded wives that you are who God called you to be, and you're to come alongside of them, and that you are in the church. We do come to church. But that the wife's concern is of the world. And how I may please my husband. You have to see some faces like, no, we use church. And she was like, if you in church 3 or 4 times a week, something's wrong. Because your ministry is your husband. God understands. He gave the word. She gave the scripture and everything. She said, your concern is of the world and how you may please your husband. And she gave the testimony of how when Pastor Dave went away for the 10 days in Israel, how every day she gave a gift. She went to the airport, gave Dr. Proctor a suitcase with 10 days worth of gift to present to Dr. Dave every day while he was in Israel. Those ladies lost it. The one lady out there, she said, oh, my husband about to get something in the mail. I don't even know. It was a woman who would be celebrating her 49th year anniversary. She said, oh my God, I learned something today. She said, I've been so sarcastic and maybe just who I was and who I thought I was on. okay being. She said, but today, Christ celebrates 49 years of marriage. I've got to do something different. She was so sincere. Then the woman who just happened to be walking by Pastor Glenn's session, she said she knew she was supposed to just come in. She was a vendor. She wasn't in any session, but she was walking by. She came in and sat in the back. And she just got blessed in her marriage. She said, because she realized she hadn't been doing some of the things. They just really thought that the husbands, you do this, you do that. Not I'm required. But Pastor Byrne released over them. She gave them the word. She gave them demonstration. But most of all, she gave them hope. Amen. Every one of them women, I'm telling you, we stayed almost a half an hour after because they just wanted to talk to her, telling her plans, telling her what they're about to do. The one lady, they all going to be at the marriage thing all the time. But I'm telling you, I thank God for Pastor Bernadette's obedience. I thank God for her going in bold, not holding back no matter what the atmosphere is. She gave them God's word, and there are, I know, over 30 plus wives that are so different and have husbands as well.
I just say thank you, Elder One, for being there. Thank you so much, Sheree. But thank you for sharing this morning. You know, it just was an awesome experience. And I couldn't say anything different than what Elder has said. But one of the things when Pastor David and I woke up this morning, we were just talking about God's goodness. And I was just saying, you can be going through something for 49 years and come in the presence of God for one moment. And one word from the Lord, if you're open, can change your circumstances forever. Forever. I didn't know she was married for 49 years. I didn't know what her circumstances were. But God knew and He loved her so much. He prepared and she was able to. There was a lady who spoke to mental health presenter.
Yes.
She said, my marriage is healed today, and I've not gotten home yet. I've been teaching you how to be emotionally and socially stable. She said, but I'm totally detached from my
husband. Yes,
she was a powerful presenter. Everything she shared was truth and powerful. She said, but I'm not home yet, but my marriage is healed. She said, and I am. And this moment, I'm going to do what God would have me do. See, it doesn't matter if the other person does something. It's what I'm willing to do. Since I'm willing, it's already healed. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, God. I'm going to be the best, bro. Thank God for your ministry. But how God is using you to heal and how to deliver and how to be able to hear God. But also how to give God to people where they are.
Yeah.
And so I thank God for your honesty, your transparency, and your love for people. Amen. So let's celebrate Pastor Byrne one more time. Amen. Yeah, we got a couple birthdays today. Let's celebrate Minister Hutt. I know he's here. But his birthday today. Hutt, we got a surprise on for him. We can't tell you what it is, but we know. They also want to celebrate another birthday. Sister Aisha's birthday is today, too. I'm so glad I go to church. I said, why? I said, because I can call you and tell you, Pastor Dave, I ain't coming to church tomorrow. I'm going to take my wife out to a secret place for a secret. I said, go by boy, by boy. I said, hang up. Go do what thou supposed to do. Now, and hurry while you're at. So they are celebrating one another and always going to be.
Hello. Happy birthday.
I was mad. He was, he hit stop by the house, I asked him to take care of something for the house. And he said, you know, he said, I got birthdays all week. I said, what? He said, yeah, Kobe birthday was Thursday. I think Christmas birthday was Friday. Then one of the granddaughter's birthday was Saturday, and his was Sunday. I said, 4 days? He said, man, I'm going to be tired. I said, but the love and the joy celebrate. So we thank God for that. And again, through the word, thank you for your prayers. I was thinking about even as just so many things going on, but how awesome it is to know that without a doubt, that there is a prayer shield over this church. It made me think of when the enemy said, I would touch Job, but you know you got a hedge on it. Sometimes there's hedges of angels, sometimes there's hedges of spirit, but there's also a prayer hedge.
Yes.
And I believe that because you pray 365 days a week.
Yes.
Are you hearing me? 365 days a week a church prays. This church prays.
Yes.
There is a prayer hedge around your life that you have no idea how thick it is, how strong it is, because of the commitment and consistency of the people of God in this church. So I want to say thank you again. Amen.
Thank you, God.
I don't take it for granted in any kind of way. And in Romans chapter 16, it says this. It says, let me do this. I need my help. Praise God. My other help. Amen. We was in trouble last week. We had so much help around the house, we couldn't find none of our help around the house. We've been sharing glasses so much, and now some of our children are selling our glasses. So I ain't going to say nothing. Praise God. Amen. Romans chapter 16, it says this, I commend you to Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is in Central. He says that you receive her in the Lord as become of saints, and that ye assist her in whatever business she have need of you.
Yes.
For she has even been a secure of many, and of myself also, is what Paul says. And then when you read Priscilla and Aquila and all those in Christ, what's really powerful to me about what God is doing in this season? He's partnering and making the kingdom so apparent to the world in many different facets. And even as Pastor Burns talked about the old lady with mental health, Minister Sharon is licensed, yes, ordained, is empowered, is certified. I don't know, degree, thermometer in mental health. I mean in mental health. But she has the kingdom anointing too.
Yes!
And I believe that like Phoebe, Paul said, whatever business she has to do.
Yes.
Support her in that.
Yes.
I thank God for her life, for her faithfulness, her stand, her walk, her talk, and how she's come along and supported us in so many different ways. So even as Pastor Burns gonna share something, I want us, when she stand, we want to celebrate the woman of God.
Yes.
We got our own Phoebe, y'all. We got our own Phoebe. Amen. One same teacher, the partner, and help develop his people for the kingdom of God.
Amen. I just echo everything Pastor David has shared. I thank her for her friendship, her example. She doesn't like me calling her a mentor, but from a child, I call her a mentor, even though she's my friend on today. But I thank God for the precious oil on her life, for a precious, powerful stand on the word of God, for her freedom and love, for fun and laughter, but no uncompromising foolishness. Just loving God, and I thank him for her just being a reward to the body of Christ. So we just celebrate you as you come this morning in your own way. Let's honor and celebrate this precious woman of God. Amen. Glory to God. Bless the Lord. Let's give God praise this morning. It's not that moment for you to give God praise. Let's give God praise this morning. Nobody do me like Jesus. Amen. So I celebrate him today because he alone really is worthy of all of our praise, honor, and glory.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I'm excited about this word because I asked the Lord, what was I supposed to share today? And he brought me back to the fact that Pastor Dave's been preaching on faith. This series on faith, and so God told me to line up with that this morning. So that's what we're going to do in the name of Jesus. So if you have the word, would you turn to John chapter 5? St. John chapter 5. St. John chapter 5. And we're reading from verses, we'll start at 1 through 9. And it reads like this. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version of Scripture. It says, after this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there was a pool, there's a pool called in Hebrew, Bethzatha, or Bethesda in your Bibles, if you have a different version, which has five porticos. In these lay many invalids, lame, blind, and paralyzed. One man who was there had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to the man, do you want to be made well? The sick man answered him, sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm making my way, somebody else always seems to step ahead of me. Jesus said to him, stand up, take up your mat, and walk. At once, the man was made well, and he took up his mat, and he began to walk. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for fresh. God, how we give you glory on this morning for this time of word. We thank you, God, that you put a word inside of me. I pray that you would bring it out exactly how you want to be proclaimed. I pray most of all, God, that somebody in this place today will be challenged in their faith walk. That somebody in this place today will be encouraged in their faith walk. But most of all, God, that you might get glory from this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm reminded of a time, I think about 3 years ago, I was on my way to work, and I was moving. And when I was coming up McDade Boulevard to go to my office, I saw a young man and I saw a bus. The problem was the young man and the bus were not in the same spot. So the young man was trying to get to the bus. And so I heard God say, take him to the bus. Now come on, y'all know my thinking, right? For a minute. You want me to pick somebody up, a man that I do not know, and put him in my car?
Come on.
Y'all, that didn't make sense to me. And I wish somebody in the room would act like it made sense to you, but it didn't make sense to me. But I heard God say, I got you. Pick him up, take him to the bus. So I said, okay, God, since you got me, I'm going to do this. I don't really know why you got me doing this, but I'm going to do it anyhow. So I drove my car up, and I blew the horn for the young man, and I made sure he saw me. And I said, God told me to take you to that bus. Come on, baby, get it back in my car. I took him, matter of fact, I drove ahead of the bus, turned so the bus couldn't move, and dropped him off in front of the bus so they couldn't leave him. I said, have a blessed day. God was looking out for you. Listen, when I got home, I was so encouraged by that for the moment. But I heard God say to me, Sharon, there are some times when you have to have radical faith.
Come on.
Oh my God. So this morning I'm preaching from the subject, sometimes you have to have radical faith. Now listen, the word radical, it means new and different from the usual. See, the usual would have been, I saw somebody I know on the corner, that would have been the usual, and I said, girl, get in my car, get you that bus, right? But in this circumstance, it was different from the ordinary, because I didn't know that man from Adam. And the truth of the matter is, I did not know whether that man would try to rob me or anything else, but here's what I knew. God told me to do it. So sometimes, we have to have radical faith. That's different from the traditional, from the ordinary, and from the usual. Come on. So it is in our text today.
Glory to God.
In our text today, we find that there are two crowds of people mentioned in verses 1 and 2.
Yes.
The Bible says in verse 1 that there was a festival of the Jews, right? Now, y'all know festivals were celebratory time, right? Yes. So there was a whole multitude of Jews who were celebrating in Jerusalem because they were making merry, because that's what they did at a festival. Yes. They celebrated God, but they also celebrated with each other. So one crowd is in the festival having a good time in verse 1. But then we find in verses 2 through 9, there's another crowd.
Come on.
There are a crowd of people who couldn't find themselves two different circumstances. One crowd was celebrating, making merry with the other crowd. If you could imagine for a moment, probably were not having a celebratory mindset. Because they were lame, which means they couldn't walk. They were paralyzed, so they couldn't move. Watch it, but watch it. So that's the setup for the text, right?
Yeah.
But the Bible says that second crowd was laying by the pool of Bethesda.
Yeah.
Now let me teach a little bit about that. So the Bible says that they were laying at the pool of Bethesda,
yeah,
on the five porches. Now the porches were not like our porches. They were alcoves which had a covering over the top that protected people from the sun and the rain and all that kind of stuff. Nevertheless, they were out in the open laying along the side of the pool. Five porches. Y'all know that means there's a lot of people. The Bible says there's a multitude of people who are laying by the pool. But the Bible says something interesting. While they were laying by the pool, that Jesus comes across with one man.
Uh-huh.
Now I want y'all to hear me today. He's in a crowd of people. But Jesus, the Bible says, saw him and his condition. I wish somebody could hear me today. I want you to know that God told me to tell you, you might be in a crowd of people, but God sees you right where you are. He sees your circumstances. He sees your situation. He has not missed you even in the crowd. That should encourage somebody today. I don't care how many people on your job. I don't care how many people in your neighborhood. I need you to know that God sees you just where you are. He sees your circumstances. Somebody ought to say amen to God this morning. Somebody ought to say thank you, God, for seeing me. Because here's the thing I learned about God. When God sees you, he don't just see you.
Yes.
When God sees you, he doesn't just see you. When he sees you, he sees your circumstances. When he sees you, he sees what's underneath the skin. When he sees you, unlike man, he sees your mental state. When he sees you, he sees your physical state. When he sees you, he sees your relational state. God doesn't just see you, he sees you. I wish somebody could hear me this morning. Don't you remember when Hagar ran away from the house because she got tired of getting picked on by Sarai? The Bible says she ran to a wilderness. Listen to that, y'all. She lived in a palace where she had a place to lay. She had food to eat. And she found out in her own mind that I would do better in the wilderness rather than stay and live under this roof. But this is the part that blessed me. So the Bible says she moves towards the wilderness. And y'all know ain't nothing in the wilderness but lions and tigers and bears, oh my. Right? So she moves to the wilderness. And the Bible says an angel of the Lord showed up and asked her, what was she doing? And the angel told her, basically, God sees you. Now listen to me, y'all. She was so encouraged to know that God saw her. The Bible says she went back home. Now listen, don't y'all miss this. Home wasn't fixed yet. Oh my God, I was thinking about you. Home was still the same as it was when she left. But she was so encouraged to know that God saw her that she said, your name is Elroy. You're the God who sees.
Yeah.
I believe she had a sense that knowing that God showed up in the wilderness and reminded her that he saw her, that she knew he could handle herself in the palace. Somebody today, there's some things God is going to require that's going to take radical faith on your behalf. God, the Bible says that there was one man, and this is what blessed me too. The man had been lame for 38 years.
You're preaching.
Yes. Listen to me. 38 years.
Uh-huh.
456 months. 13,870 days. This man never walked. For 38 years, I wish somebody hit me today. He never walked for 38 years. For 456 months, this man did not walk. For 13,000, for 870 days, he didn't walk. What's the significance, Reverend White? Listen, it does not matter how long you've been dealing with a thing. I wish somebody could hear me. It does not matter how long you've been going through that one thing. It matters not to God how long it takes for you to get your healing. What you have to understand is that while you are going through it, God is with you, and not only is he with you, it has an expiration date. Oh my God, I wish somebody could hear me today. I wish somebody could hear me today. I wish somebody would hear me say it doesn't matter how long you've been struggling with that thing, and it doesn't even matter if it doesn't look good to you that you can't go to the festival. festival because you're too concerned about your circumstances. Oh. What I want to encourage you with today, it has an expiration date.
Yes.
Oh, come on, listen. Listen, listen, listen. I had some yogurt in the refrigerator.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I looked at it, and it had an expiration date.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I said, it means it is no good for me now. Oh my God, I just said something. Whatever you're dealing with, the expiration date means that thing is no longer going to be useful to you. Because God is about to do something different. 38 years. Can you imagine? 456 months. 13,870 days. He lives like this. So he does what everybody else does.
Uh-huh.
They go to the pool. Because that's what sick folk did. They went to the pool.
Yeah.
Because there was a belief that when you got to the pool, if you were the first person in the water, the water would be stirred by an angel and you would be healed. So he did the ordinary of the day. He went to the pool. Because that's all they knew. But remember, God said some things gonna take radical faith.
Yeah.
God is not always gonna move the way you expect him to move. God is not always gonna use what you expect to use. God is not, listen, God is so big.
Come,
he's so awesome.
Yes,
he is. He's so amazing.
Yes,
he literally can make a way out of no way for you.
Yeah. Come on.
Listen, I remember some years ago, God challenged me with that whole statement. Try to make a way out of no way, right? We're all saying that stuff, right? But the Lord told me this. Some of y'all saying that on Tuesday. Because you know a check is coming on Friday.
You better.
Oh my God. He said some of y'all saying that on Monday. Because you know your direct deposit is going to show up on Thursday. He said, but there's another group of folks who understand that there's no check coming on Friday. There will not be a direct deposit on Thursday. But they still believe that I'm going to do what I'm going to do on their behalf. This man did what everybody else did. He couldn't celebrate with the folks at the festival. But he went to the pool every day. Now what's interesting about that is, the Bible says Jesus saw him laying there, right? And knew he had been there for a long time. See, God knows how long you've been dealing with that. God knows how long that thing's been hurting your heart. God knows how long you've been struggling financially. God knows how long your children have been acting like they don't even know God. God knows how long your boss has been giving you a problem on the job. God knows how long you've been praying for a house. God knows how long. He knows how long.
The
Bible says, after that, Jesus looks at the man. Looks at the man. Now listen, y'all. Take your spiritual hats off for just a moment, all right? Jesus says to the man, do you want to be made well? Now listen, y'all. I'm going to use me. If Jesus had said that to me, I would be like, that's a ridiculous question.
Right.
I'm at the pool for a reason. Y'all, think with me. Think with me. If it was me, I would be like, you asking me, do I want, what? You think I'm laying in this pool just to lay here? Do I want to be made well? Really? What kind of question is that? But he says to him, do you want to be made well? Dude, somebody today, Jesus is saying, do you want to be made well? Whatever that thing is that you come to church every Sunday smiling about, you smile and say hallelujah every Sunday. Even you in Cyberland, what are you faking the funk about? Do you really want to be made well? Is it time to deal with the anger issues? Is it time to let God heal the resentment and the bitterness? Is it time to allow God to fix that thing that you've been trying to fix on your own?
Jesus,
glory
to God.
Jesus asked me a question. Listen to the man's answer. Man said, sir, I don't have anybody to put me in that pool when the water gets stirred. And matter of fact, when I try to get in, somebody always gets ahead of me. Stop right there. The problem with the man's answer is it did not match Jesus' question. Y'all think with me for a second. Jesus didn't say, can you get in the pool? He didn't say, do you want to get in the pool? Would you like me to help you in the pool? That's not what he said. He said, do you want to be made well?
Yeah. Come on.
In other words, the man was giving Jesus excuses. He didn't fully understand who he was engaged with, Pastor David. Because if he did, he would have answered the question.
Yeah.
But instead of answering Jesus' question, he gives him excuses. I can't get in the pool. The people keep getting in the pool before me. What excuses are you giving God while he's trying to bless your life? What excuses are you using when God is trying to bless you, but you keep coming with excuses about why you can't have it, can't do it, can't see it, won't have it, won't show up? What excuses are you using today? God says, I don't care about your excuses. I want to know, do you want to be made well?
Yes.
Teaching up in
here. Yeah. So you got a moment of choice today, yeah, and you don't even understand it. I want to know, do you want to be made well?
And here's the other thing that God showed me when I was studying. He said, anybody always jumping in front of me? Anybody put me in? God says, some of us are relying too much on people, mm-hmm, and not enough on him.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
God says, some of us are waiting for the hookup from sister girl on the job. And he said, you never asked me. Some of us are more concerned about who can open doors for us in the natural realm. And he said, if you don't understand, in the spirit realm, I got you. I got you. And listen, and God is so awesome. He said, listen, I don't even need your resources. Oh my God, listen. When I went to buy my house, they told me bring a cashier's check for some thousands of dollars. Let's get the number. $4,000, whatever, right?
Yes.
So I go to the bank, get the cashier's check, because that's what the people tell me I need.
Yes.
I get the check. Go to settlement. Person who was supposed to help me wasn't there. God said, I need him, Daddy. I'm here.
Yes.
Oh, I wish I heard that. And when a friend of mine who was a finance person, he was supposed to be there.
Yeah.
He didn't show up.
Yeah.
For a moment, Pastor Vernon, I panicked. But then God said, I'm here. I'm here, and all of a sudden a calm got over me, because my daddy was there.
Yeah.
And this is what I know about my daddy. My daddy has shown me that he never fails. He has shown me that he's the best keeper there is. He has shown me that he shows up in big places in my life that I can't even show up for myself. So watch this. So we sit at the table. We're almost done, unbeknownst to me. My realtor says, you have $20? I said, yeah, I got $20. So I reached in my purse, gave me $20. I'm signing papers. Okay, we're done. So I don't want to say nothing. I don't want to say anything about the check. Sometimes God tell you, keep your mouth shut. So I ain't saying nothing about the check. So when I got outside, I said to my realtor, I said, what about that check? She said, that's yours. You don't need it. Look at God. Come on, y'all.
Come on.
But the awesome thing, according to the text,
right.
is that I got something there figured out. I ain't got nothing to lose till I try it again.
Yeah.
So the Bible says he got up.
Yeah.
He picked up his bed and he walked.
Yeah.
Oh my God. God worked a miracle out for him right while God, when Jesus was speaking.
Yeah.
No, listen. Lame today. 12 o'clock noon, I'm lame. Jesus says, get up, take up your bed, and walk. It wasn't a day later that I got to walk. The Bible, listen, the Bible says immediately.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I wish somebody could hear me today. Some of your immediately answers are based on your obedience to God. Listen. What do you think would happen when Jesus says to the man, stand up? Come on, y'all. You know some of us would be like, now, Jesus, you know I can't stand up. I ain't stood up in 138 years. Right? That sounds good and natural. But radical means out of the ordinary. It means different. It means unusual. So there's sometimes when God wants us to just do what he says, even though it doesn't seem like something we're used to. Even if it's not the way we would have wanted it to happen. And watch, when we do, he can speak immediately over your circumstances. And change the very trajectory of your life. Listen, that man went from being lame to being able to walk down the street and shout and tell people about Jesus.
Yes!
All because he had enough sense to do what Jesus said. So again, the Bible says immediately he got up, picked up his bed, and walked. And what's significant about that is, again, God did it his way.
Yes!
Many of us are literally on the cusp of God doing something great for us. The deciding factor is obedience.
Yes.
You can do what you used to do, stay where you used to stay, rely on who you are used to relying on, or you can step out on faith and believe that God is who he's told you he is. He already told you he's Jehovah Jireh.
Yes.
He's our provider. Why do you think he can't give you that? I wish I could. Why do you want this?
Jesus.
You really think God can't do that? You really think that God can't give you a house? He's been giving out houses for years. You think he can't give you a house? You think God can't heal your marriage? He's been healing marriages forever. You think God can't hold you in your single state? He's been holding singles all their life. On your behalf. Oh, I wish somebody could hear me. The criteria of it though is, are we doing what we're supposed to do in obedience to God? Because if we are, we can trust that God has got us and he'll fix the thing. But you gotta have radical faith. Radical faith says, when my bosses treat me horrible, I'm not gonna cuss her out. When my bosses treat me really bad, I'm not gonna start coming to work late trying to prove a point. Radical faith says, I'm gonna show up. To show up, work really hard, because I'm not working to my boss, I'm working as unto God.
Yeah.
And when I work as unto God, God is obligated to fulfill his word.
Yeah.
Don't you love it when you can hold God to his word?
Come on.
Listen, I know some people, their word ain't worth a nickel, but I promise you this, God is worth everything he says.
Yeah.
He can do what he says, how he wants to do it.
Yeah.
And don't need to ask nobody for permission.
Come on.
You know what's funny? God just dropped that in my spirit. I remember I was talking to somebody about ministry.
Yeah.
And I could tell they were waiting for somebody to validate them. And I said, listen, I pray you get to the place in your life where man's validation is not as important as God's obedience and people what God says. I pray you get to the place where you're not waiting for somebody else to tell you how good you are. You will believe God when he said, I put you in this place for a reason. I want to use you for a reason. And all I need you to do is get up and put you one foot in front of the other.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
Come on.
At least I hold you too long. Bible says, Jesus said to him, I said, all right, And he said, and me too, we've been one, right? And I want to stop there because, you know, the next verse is waving because it talks about the Sabbath, but we're not going there because God gave me some faith principles, radical faith principles, and I'm taking my seat.
Yeah.
But this is what God gave me about this whole idea of radical faith.
Yeah.
God said, radical faith expects God to move in dead situations.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Come on.
Oh, my God.
Come on.
Radical faith believes that God can move in dead situations.
Yes.
Your marriage might appear dead. Your health, sometimes you might feel like there's just no end to it, but God is able. And he wants you to have the kind of faith that says, God, I don't know when you're going to heal. God, I don't know when you're going to deliver. God, I don't even know how, but I believe you are going to because you work best in dead situations. Now, in case y'all don't believe me, don't you remember Lazarus? He was there for 4 days when Jesus showed up. And the Bible says that Jesus purposely delayed his arrival. Why? Because he wanted us to understand that God is a God who can heal dead things. And watch this. And I believe that God wanted us to understand that it was nobody but him. So that's why he let him stay dead for 4 days. Because 3 days, they would have said, well, you know, maybe he wasn't really dead. He was asleep. No, he was dead dead. Yeah. Somebody in the room. Yeah. I don't know what feels dead dead to you. Yeah. But God says, you need to have enough radical faith to believe that I can handle the dead dead stuff. Oh, my God. Gosh. I just want you to have enough faith, an extraordinary kind of faith. Yeah. When everybody else says it cannot be done, you're looking at God saying, God, I'm waiting on you.
Yes.
Radical faith knows that God moves in unexpected ways, unconventional ways. See, we're trying to get a raise by working harder and working longer, and that's fine. But God says, if you bring your tithes into the storehouse and bring your offering into the storehouse, I can give you a raise, and your boss still might not like you. Oh, my God. Unconventional ways if you let listen. Radical faith leads to obedience to God even when it doesn't make sense.
Yes.
Oh, come on, y'all. You know, listen, anybody here want to be honest and say, sometimes God tell me to do stuff and I'll be like, that don't even make sense.
But
because I know him, I'll do it anyhow.
Yes.
And y'all don't believe me. Don't you remember when Jesus showed up at the wedding in Cana of Galilee? He shows them at the wedding, they run out of wine.
That's right.
They say, ain't no wine. Yes. Now, y'all have to remember, it's embarrassing for a host to run out of wine at a wedding.
Yes.
You become the talk of the town if you run out of wine at a wedding.
Yes.
They put your stuff on the express mail if you run out of wine at a wedding in Cana of Galilee, right?
Yes.
So the Bible says his mama, with a mother's wisdom, tells the servant, listen, I can imagine, I don't know how you're going to do it, but I know you got seen it work miracles.
Yeah.
I know you're going to do it. So she tells the servants, whatever he tells you to do, do it. And the Bible says, Jesus said, fill up that vat with some water. And what blows my mind is, Jesus simply spoke to the water. You're now wine. Because he doesn't, listen, he moves in ways we can't expect, can't imagine. But when he does it, you know it's him. And I believe sometimes that's why God does that too.
Yeah.
So you will never mistake and give anybody else praise for what belongs to him. And listen, and Jesus' miracle was so awesome in that text that the Bible says the people said, oh man, you served the best wine for last. You tricked us. But that was the power of God. Radical faith does that, y'all. Radical faith does it. And then listen. Radical faith believes more than you can see.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
Listen to me. Many of us are stuck in, I can't see it. I can't see that.
Come on.
I've never done that before.
Come on.
I ain't never had that. Ain't nobody in my family ever.
Come on.
Nobody in my neighborhood ever.
Come on.
I ain't had no role model do that before, Pastor Dave.
Come on.
But God told me to tell somebody today, stop relying on what you can see.
Come on.
And rely on who you know.
Yeah.
my word. Keep watching the miracles. Go to John and see how I did stuff. Don't you remember the servant asked Jesus? He said, listen, can you heal my servant at home? And he was a leader and a soldier. And he said, Jesus, he told Jesus, he said, listen, this blessing me. Slow down, Sharon, slow down. Because this text blesses me all the time. The Bible says that Jesus said, your faith is amazing. Because a man said, you ain't even got to go to the house. If you were just speaking, it would happen. Jesus was so outdone by the man's faith. He said, listen, now listen. This man wasn't even an Israelite. And Jesus was with his people. And he had followers with him, right? So you know Jesus knew a whole lot of Jews, a whole lot of Israelites. But listen to what Jesus says, y'all. Because I want this to be my testimony. He said, I never seen a faith like that. Oh my God. So can you imagine? Can you imagine that he says, your faith is amazing to me, the Savior? Can you imagine that he says it to a non-Jew? Can you imagine that once all his people are around and he still says, the testimony is that this man's faith right here blew my mind. I dare somebody today. I dare somebody today to have such a radical faith that you believe God no matter what. That you don't tell God how to do it, you just ask him to do it. You don't tell God where to go, you just tell him the circumstances. You don't tell him how much, you just tell him what the need is.
I love it.
I don't know about you, but I want that to be my testimony today. That God in heaven is looking at me going, I ain't never seen things like that before. She got that on lock. I can give anything she wants, but she got that on lock.
Got it on lock.
Yes, got it.
I'm very close.
All right.
But the other thing that God gave me last night, radical faith recognizes that God's timing is perfect.
Yes.
Hear me, y'all.
Come on.
Radical faith knows that God's timing is always perfect.
Yes.
Listen, can you imagine that in Batman that day? Before he encounters Jesus, 38 years, 456 months, 13,870 days. He's lame. He probably was just going through the motions, even to try to get in the water. Because it's been so long with him being lame. But that day, Jesus showed that man that my timing is always perfect. Because there will not be a 13,871 days of you being lame. Somebody better hear me today. God told me to tell you and declare this, that I promise you, it doesn't matter how long you've been dealing with that issue. It doesn't matter how long you've been struggling. It doesn't matter how long you cried. It doesn't matter how long you prayed. It doesn't matter how long you fasted. In his time, he's going to do it. In his time, he's going to do it. And when he shows up, he does it right.
Yeah.
And listen, y'all, this is the thing I'm closing really with this. Yeah, I am.
It's all right.
But this is the thing that blows my mind about God. See, sometimes I believe that God makes us wait to what looks like midnight. To what looks like it's midnight. Y'all know midnight is the darkest time of the day. It looks like it's impossible. It just looks like it's never going to happen. Because it's midnight. But God shows up at midnight, watch this, to teach us that he's the God of midnight. Oh my God, I wish you could hear me. He shows us, watch this, that nobody is going to take credit for what I do. He shows us that he can snatch us from the brink of despondency because he shows up right on time. His timing is always perfect. And when he shows up, he shows out. And then what he does, can you imagine the man, everybody knew he had been lame all of years, right? Can you imagine he's now walking down the street?
Right.
Come on, y'all, you should think about that. Can you imagine everybody knowing he was there for 38 years? Watch this. Even the people who jumped in the pool before him, who got their healing, they knew he was lame.
Right.
So can you imagine? He's now walking down the street. Now y'all know he ain't just walking either. He prayed to God right about now. Oh my God, I know. Listen, I couldn't walk before, but you know I'm walking now. Girl, listen, I'm walking now. is moving through town.
Come on.
And y'all know they probably wouldn't put him in the Daily Gazette because they didn't see him like that before. Because watch this. You know when they asked him how he got healed.
Come on,
and they thought he got in the pool. He had to correct them. He said, no, I didn't make it to that pool.
Yeah, yeah.
But I met Jesus. Yeah. And Jesus did some miraculous. Yeah. He healed me without the water. Yeah. I met Jesus and he did something that nobody ever saw before. He healed me by his word.
Yeah.
I met Jesus and he did what I didn't know he could do. He supernaturally spoke my healing and then I walked in.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Can you imagine? He's skipping through town. Now listen, watch this. I have to believe, Pastor Dave and Pastor Byrne, that folks in town was like blown away. And I have to believe that they wanted to meet this Jesus who had healed this man without the pool, without the people, without the press. So I have to believe they wanted to see this Jesus. So sometimes when God does stuff for us, it's so he can show his power to the onlookers. He can show his power to those who don't believe. He can show his power to those who never experienced his power. He can show his power in such a way that somebody else might want to know him. Do you not understand that when we have radical faith, we're literally showing that we expect God to do it however he wants to do it. My hands above God, what you want to do. And as I close, I'm reminded of that same story I started with. That I took the man to the bus.
Yes.
And I got him on the bus because I was intentional by blocking off the bus.
Yes.
Because God told me my assignment was to get him on that bus.
Yes.
And didn't stop and just pulled behind the bus. And when God spoke to me and said, that's because I wanted you to have radical faith.
Yes.
I wanted you to believe me for a circumstance you never were in before.
Yes.
And I wanted you to see that I could cover you in those circumstances.
Yeah.
And he said to me, Sharon, this is the kind of faith that I want you to have in your life.
Yeah.
Because there's going to be many times when you can't see what I'm doing.
Yeah.
There's going to be many times when I don't show up when you want me to, but I'm going to be on top. There's going to be many times, Sharon, when I want folks to see what I do in your life by the testimony that you give.
Yeah.
So somebody today, God said, listen, I know when you show up, it looks good.
Uh-huh.
I know when you show up, it sounds good.
Yeah, yeah.
But the stuff that you stop believing me for,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to need you to have radical faith that I've done it.
Yeah.
And I might not have done it when you want it. But I always show up on time.
Yeah.
You can take that to the bank.
Uh-huh.
The stuff that you think you cannot have,
uh-huh.
when you look at you can see the problem. He said, listen, you keep going to your bank book.
Mm-hmm.
The numbers ain't changing.
Come on.
But what I want you to do is look at me.
Yeah.
I got so much stuff. The word says the cattle that sits on a thousand hills belongs to me. What is it that you want? What is it that you need? Stop doubting me and believe me.
Yeah.
And exercise radical faith.
Yeah.
You ain't got to have the hookup because you hooked up with me.
Come on.
You ain't got to be looking at man to fix your stuff because you hooked up with me. You ain't gotta expect somebody else to do it. I need you to look at me. As a matter of fact, everybody that you want to rely on, I'll shut it down.
Yeah.
Somebody hear me today. God says, listen, the people that you want to be able to say did it, if you take your eyes off me, I'll shut them down. Somebody hear me. The people that you expect, the stuff that you expect. I was so blessed by the book on the prayer of Jabez. There's a chapter in there where talks about resources. And I'm closing for real this time. I know what I'm saying. But I was so blessed by one thing he said. He said, because you know he says enlarge my territory all the time.
Yes.
He says, God's blessing on me is not contingent upon my resources.
Mm.
It's contingent upon who he is.
Yes.
So it would be good for us to remember, y'all, that whatever we need, healing, he got it. Restoration, he got it. A new house, he got it. And this is the other thing about God. He don't just give us some of our wants. Aren't y'all excited? We can praise God that sometimes he gives us. Let me say that again. He doesn't just give us our needs. He gives us what we want to. Can anybody here praise God that you didn't have to ask just for your wants, but you can ask God, God, I want that new dress in heaven. God, I want that new car in heaven. God, I want that house in heaven. God, I want that new joint in heaven.
You know,
amen. to take radical faith
yes.
to get what I got for you.
Yes.
To get it where I want to give it to you.
Yes.
I mean, to blow your own mind by how I do it. But it starts with radical faith. It's not an ordinary faith that says God's going to make a way out of nowhere on Friday when you know you're on Tuesday when you know your check is coming on Friday. It literally is radical faith that says there is no more money in the bank. I ain't got money for a trespass on Thursday, but I'm going to get myself together and get ready for work because somebody will give me a trespass.
Yeah.
I don't have down payment.
Come on,
God. You can get to the table and they say you don't need it.
Come on.
God says, that's who I am.
Yeah.
And I try to show you that. So the only thing that's keeping you from getting what you want from God is your obedience.
Yeah.
And it starts with your having faith. That was faith that doesn't see.
Yeah.
Or faith that believes.
Yeah.
Faith that doesn't have to see it.
Come on.
There's some stuff y'all got that has done for me that I didn't see it. I thought I did not see it. And I looked around and I'm living in it.
Yeah.
And I got right on my face, y'all. I believe God.
Come on, God. Let's stand to our feet. Let's celebrate the Lord. Come on and give him a shout of praise for radical faith. For radical faith. For radical faith. For radical faith. Radical faith. Radical faith. Radical faith. God, we thank you for radical faith. God, we're not looking for the usual. We're not looking for the pedestrian. We're not looking for the mundane. We're looking for something radical, God. God, give us that radical faith. Not what we see, God. Not what we understand, God. Not based on accounts, God. But radical faith. Radical faith that calls the dead to live. Radical faith that calls the deaf to hear. Radical faith, Father God, that calls those that can't speak to speak, oh God. Radical faith, God, that they would know it was our God that does exploits through his people, God. God, we expect you today.
Yes.
And our faith has been pushed to another place in you.
Yes.
Thank you that you are increasing our faith.
Yes.
Even to a radical faith. Come on and celebrate it one more time. Amen. Yeah. Wow. 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 And radical faith. What'd you receive today? What'd you receive today? What'd you receive today? Give me one or two things that you receive. What'd you receive today?
Radical faith believes God can heal dead situations.
Come on. Yeah.
And not just dead situations.
Dead.
I got that. I said dead. I said dead. Somebody else, help me out.
Some of your immediate answers are dependent on your path of faith.
Yes. I love it. Your immediate response is going, your obedience is going to take immediate in the eye of your
response. Yes.
Help me out, people.
He didn't need the water or a person.
Wow.
He didn't need the person.
He wanted to be healed.
He didn't even need what she was looking for to do what he needed to do in your life.
Yes.
Help me out, sir.
Yeah.
Even when he made an excuse, he still moved.
Yes.
Ain't nobody ready. I ain't even talk to you about anybody.
Yes.
By the way, just be quiet if you do. Really, just be God. Just let me be God.
Yes.
Can you just let God be God?
Yes.
Yes.
What?
Man,
God's timing is perfect.
Man.
Yes.
Man.
Amen.
It is perfect all the time, every time. His timing is perfect all the time.
Every time.
Yes.
When God sees you, he don't just see you, he sees your circumstances.
Yes.
Come on. When God sees you, he sees your circumstances.
Wow.
I put next to mine. When God sees you, he sees all of you.
Yes.
All of you. Let him see you now. He sees you back home, back at the house, with your family, with your own child. Pass the situation and on to the next one. He sees not just you, but all of them. Come here, though.
It does not matter how long it takes. It has an expiration date on
it. Come on. It has an expiration date.
Over time.
You said it about yogurt. I said, man, that's print. And some of our expirations dates are pronounced.
Yes.
Do you want to be made whole? If he would have said yes,
I know that's right.
He didn't even have to say nothing. God was like, no, I'm here to change it. Do you want change?
Yes.
The issue is, do you even want it? How do you respond when change shows up? Can you change when he shows up and change our situations? Radical faith. Somebody say hallelujah. Father, we pray you now that you continue to bless Mrs. Sharon, Lord God. We ensure yourself mighty in her life, over her life, to her life, Lord God. I thank you that even today, Father God, she released what you gave her, God. It ministered to our lives, God. That word, Father, poured out in us and on us and over us, as well as in the airways and byways, God. That somebody received faith, Father God, like never before. And that faith's been strengthened today. That faith been pushed today. God, they're going from the regular faith to radical faith. God, let us go for radical faith, God. Do something we haven't done. Go somewhere we haven't gone. See something we haven't seen. Be something we haven't been, God. Call for radical faith. Limits are being shifted even in this moment. God, we thank you. We expect you. And we believe you today. In Jesus' name. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Radical faith. Recognizing that God's timing is perfect. Believing for more than what you can see.
Yes.
He's the obedience that in the midst of every place. And God knows, knows that he will do more than the he'll do it even beyond the unconventional. Mm. And expect God to move in dead situations.
Yes.
Say to God, I got
radical faith.
No, tell the devil too. I got
radical faith.
Yeah, every now and then you gotta say it out loud to yourself.
Yes.
I was laughing, this guy, I was watching, he said, God said, how you gonna do that? He said, I don't know. He said, what you mean you don't know? He says, on God.
That's right.
Then I had to pay it back. When he said it, I was like, what he said was, whatever's about to happen, I believe that it's on God.
Yeah.
That's radical faith.
Yes.
This one is on God. Because when you have radical faith, what you see, what you hear, what you feel does not stop your faith.
Yes.
You go to a place of being radical and trusting God for where he is. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
If you're here, and I want you to be excited about this, and you never want to leave your presence without you having an opportunity to know the radical God of a radical faith.
Yes.
You say a radical God? Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know nobody that would leave a perfect heaven. But a radical God.
Yes.
I don't know nobody who will come and live 33 years quietly in the earth, but a radical God. I don't know nobody that literally will go to the cross and die for my sin and your sin, but a radical God. Because he got radical love that we could have radical faith.
Yes.
If you're here, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, you want to give you an opportunity to ask him to come into your heart and save you. You say, it was radical. It's so radical, he went to hell for you.
Yes.
I know other people say, I went to hell for you, but Jesus went to hell for you. That's how radical.
Hallelujah.
He took on death for me. That's how radical. Then he got up. He didn't even go straight back to heaven. He hung out on the earth for 40 days. Because he that radical. He told people, touch my hands. Fill the holes. I know it's kind of radical. Walk through walls. It's kind of radical. He's not. We have a radical God that says if you can have radical faith, you can have a radical walk every day of your life.
Amen.
Just ask God to come into your life and say, wherever you are, Lord, I love you and I thank you that I confess with my mouth, believe in my heart, that God has raised Christ from the dead. Through him, I'm saying, come into me, save me, heal me, refresh me, live in me and take over my life and live through my life, not a regular life, but a radical life that shows radical faith. We thank you for it even today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I want to give you a hand up there. You heard this song, right? I heard this song, right? And it was just making me think about an offering time. And he wouldn't even talk about offering time. But it just blessed me because it goes along with what Pastor, what Mr. Sharon was saying about this radical faith. This radical faith and having that sometimes you got to speak something over
come
your
on,
life till you know it's yours and you can have it. So on this new kingdom CD that Maverick did, this is this part that Earth Franklin speaks to, and I thought it was perfect for offering, because I want you to declare it while you give it. I want you to declare it while you're giving. That while you're giving, God wants to bless you. Say, bless me.
Bless me.
Say, he about to bless me.
He
gonna bless me. Because I'm obedient. Because my immediate obedience creates a blessing. And today, I want you, as we prepare to give our tithes and our offerings and honor God and the soul to the woman of God today, I just want you to hear it. You're going to pray about twice. Pray about two, three times while we finish up giving. Amen?
Amen.
But I want you to listen to the words and then the second time. I want you to say it loud to yourself. Amen? Somebody say amen.
Obedience to his word. Amen?
Amen.
You're not in the hands of the usher.